My special guest will be joining us in about a half an hour from now. It's he's getting ready. So anyways, I'm going to be here talking about nothing. How's that sound for you guys? Hope everybody's doing okay. Nothing really happening in my orbit other than, let's see here, I've got Hyperspace, of course, on KCOR Radio Live. So if you want to catch my show twice a week, it's a different format, a little bit different. But if you want to catch it, it's at KCOR Radio out of Las Vegas Live at 12 midnight Eastern Standard Time. And that's over there. So if you guys want to tune into that show, feel free to do that on a Friday night. And then we've got the Ravenstar Witching Hour here at freedomslips.com. If you guys want information on me, it's Night Shadow Anomaly Detectives. And, of course, my books are available on Amazon. So that's me. I don't really talk about me a whole lot, as you all know, but most of you know who I am. And I've been here for a while, published author, martial artist, black belt, instructor, all that good stuff. A lot of experience in covert technology. And if you really need to know more about me, you can read my books. How's that sound? So anyways, and not much, I don't want to sit here and rant about the BS that's going on here on the planet and the illusion of it, because everything around us is so disconcerting and frustrating because it's such a lie and deception. And I'm getting to the point right now where I'm done with it. I'm pretty sure everybody else is too. You get tired of being on the front lines communicating truth when everybody's just so conditioned and trained to participate with the illusion that they just don't pay attention. You know, it's getting to that level. And I appreciate all the people here at Revolution Radio who stand up and are really trying to do some really good work and talking about truth at its highest, at least trying to get the message out. And most people are just oblivious, I swear. So it really is very frustrating for a lot of us who have been on the front lines of communication. And you'll notice that, I started talking about covert technology way before a lot of people were even talking about synthetic telepathy, even though there were articles about it with the military, because they worked on that a long, long time ago. John Alexander, Colonel John Alexander, and all the whole lot was working on artificial telepathy. So this isn't anything new. So when they start deploying that type of technology with psychotronics and neural interface, it's not foreign, guys. This is a real technology. And that's one of the reasons I've always talked about it. But I'll tell you, as I watch the mainstream, I'm watching this participation of this illusion, and I'm seeing all these children and all these teenagers and all these young adults that are so out of touch. They're so disjointed. They're so disconnected. I mean, where are they? Where's the heart of this country? It's just unbelievable when I look around and I see that they're absolutely asleep. And those that are being slept are kind of being activated as like Manchurian programs or something. They're just literally acting hostile, violent, no respect for each other, no courtesy for each other. I mean, they all need to be in a martial arts class, because it's the first thing you learn in martial arts is courtesy. Bow, 101, man. And if you don't have courtesy, you get kicked out. So I think everybody should be forced into martial arts. I'll be honest with you, as a martial arts instructor, I can tell you point blank, I think everybody, even children, should be in martial arts, because it teaches them respect, courtesy, and controlling themselves, controlling their energy, and learning how to control their emotions. And I think that we have a lot of problems here in this country, and we have a lot of immature people in the illusion of power. We've got a D.C. area that's pathetic. We've got Congress that's pathetic. We've got senators that are pathetic. We've got people in the military that are embarrassing. I'm sorry, guys. There are a lot of you that are really good out there, but I don't see you right now. And this country's in the sewer. And I can go on and on. You guys know me, man, because when I get fired up, boy. And I'll be switching gears when my guest comes online, because he's going to be talking about Rod Serling. We're going to have a good time and talk some other stuff, science fiction oriented. But I'll tell you, it's interesting how we look. And speaking of science fiction, you look around and you see science fiction in a sense that where these people were writing an escape, or were they writing something that's really paralleling the truth of what's happening? And I think all of you can understand that most of science fiction has been written in a formula that's literally about the truth, but it's masked so that people can digest it a little bit easier. They do that a lot in Hollywood, obviously, stealing information. That's another thing I wanted to address real quick. I've heard this more than once about what's going on in Area 51 and the illusion of that little place, which isn't so little. But, the whole thing about this country and this world right now is global surveillance. It's all about covert surveillance. It's all about you being looked at and scrutinized through a microscope, psychotronic warfare, you name it. This is what it's about, surveillance at its worst. And these divisions in these areas that are infesting over there with Area 51, for example, I'm just going to throw that at you guys, is because it's all connected now with CIA. And we all know that CIA are the game players. Everything they do is a game. In other words, if they give you one piece of good data, the rest of it's crap, and you can't trust a word they say. So the one thing I will tell you about what I've learned from just being around people who are ex-operatives is that you can't trust a gosh darn thing they say. Maybe a few of them, but not very many. Most of them are compromised. Most of them are fractured. And most of them are getting paid to lie and to cause, try to give you a piece of data that's semi, maybe a little bit truth to it, but most of it is surrounded by so much BS that you have to sift through and use your intuition to go beyond it all. So You know, I get pretty frustrated with that, but I have seen, this is my profiling the areas over there right now at Area 51 S4 and these, the Area 6 and all this. It's all about controlled surveillance. It's all about what they're trying to do to globally take over and control and manipulate not only brainwave activity, but everything you do, say, speak, communicate. I really think that they're pushing an agenda that is literally out of control with transhumanism. After I've been pulled into this covert technology in 2004, I mean, I can tell you, I know exactly how it works and how it operates. And for those of you who don't get what I'm saying, when you get pulled into artificial telepathy, it takes over your brain. I mean, literally, you have to fight to, in your own body to defend yourself through the communication system. It's a hellacious program. And I actually got through that program. But I'll tell you point blank, man, most people wouldn't survive an hour, okay? I'm not kidding you. They wouldn't survive an hour. So understand it very clearly. If you get a, if you ever get pulled into these programs where they're trying to entrain you, they want to take your rights away to freedom of speech. They want to take your freedom of speech away. They want to take your rights away. Well, the next step is to indoctrinate you into the neural interface, which literally is the electronic god that is there to communicate a feedback every time you communicate with your own mind, quietly or verbally. It can actually assault you while you're verbally. Say I'm speaking right now. It can actually attack me while I'm speaking to make me stop talking. It can create seizures. It can take you down remotely. It can cause a heart attack. It can. It's basically a lethal weapon. They say it's non-lethal. It's lethal. Why am I talking about this? Well, I've got about 20 minutes to burn, and I figure that this is my area, and I figure maybe you should pay attention. So, and you won't hear me here forever, as I said before. I know I said that, you know, because I've been with this station now for, what, 4 years, plus or minus the illusion of, and I always wonder every Saturday night why I'm here. And nothing against the station, nothing at all. I just get tired of communicating, and I realize people listen, but really, are you listening? Are you paying attention? Are you doing something? Are you just watching TV and behind the scenes or coloring or something? You know, you have to ask yourself. So I hope you digest some of this data. I hope somebody's benefited on some level, because a lot of us have been really, really been going out there and doing things that literally our military should be doing or the real government should be doing. If we had a real respectable government, they would be doing what I'm doing. They would be communicating how there's a misuse of covert technology that's destroying people's lives. That's a war crime. That's literally destroying brainwaves. That's killing people remotely and silently and nobody knows. Or it's putting people in a space of mental illness when they're not mentally ill because it's creating a schism due to the directed energy weapon and the neural assault program. And I'm addressing this because I know damn well that these guys are deploying this stuff and they're going full speed ahead. Full speed ahead, big time. So I think everybody's looking at the elections and wondering what's going to happen. And I know where you guys are. You know, a lot of people hate Trump. I like Trump. I like him a lot. And he's, you know, he's got my vote in the illusion of. But I'll tell you point blank, you know, if he doesn't get into office, and I mentioned this on Mark Snyder's show, it's over for you guys. I hope you understand that. I hope you're understanding. I hope you like your Kool-Aid. I hope you're understanding what the hell's going on here, because we're not going to have a country anymore if people don't stand up and take their power back and stop allowing themselves to be manipulated by these cabals. We have a global agenda that's full speed ahead, goose-stepping across the board here, and people are being slept, and I don't understand it. You know, I have situation awareness, and I'm not paranoid. I'm just very grounded, and especially after I've been with where I've been with the covert technology, I'm really solid. But I see what's going on here. I'm like, I can't believe people don't freaking wake up. I mean, and I get it too. I want to be happy. I want to have a nice life. I had a nice life before they stole it from me. I mean, my life was destroyed in 2004, literally ripped away. And if anybody ever had something like that happen to them, like I said before, I don't think you guys would have made it, because there aren't very many people who can survive such an abusive assault program. But there's too much going on here simultaneously. And I think people really need to wake up and stop this BS. You know, we talk about laws out of lawlessness. I mean, there's all these things that are being pulled out of people's butts with paperwork that are saying that these laws are what they are. Well, they're not what they are. They're all created by cabals and criminal agendas. I mean, we've got to get this crap cleaned up. And how do we get it cleaned up? Well, it's across the board. And the problem is that we were the last holding ground here in America for freedom. We were the last country that was here to actually represent something pertaining to higher consciousness, maybe spiritual evolution, something that was breaking orbit and away from all these dark age mentalities across the board. And so what do we see? Cabals from the Middle East coming over here. You know, you guys know that the Arabs have been controlling and manipulating big time. I mean, I have to tell you this stuff. They bought and sold DC. I mean, how far do I have to go down this illusion of this tunnel before you guys realize that we are screwed unless changes get made here? You don't have a future for your children. You don't have a future for your grandchildren. You know, I look around every day, and this is another thing that really pisses me off. There are so many people out there taking their anger out on animals. And I'm telling you right now, if I ever catch you SOBs hurting an animal, you better hope I never find you. I will turn your asses in New York Minute, and I'm expecting law enforcement to bust them. I am so tired of watching things on Facebook with people harming animals. Leave the animals alone. If you can't control your crap, then just do something. Disappear off the earth. I don't care what you do. Leave the animals alone. That just pisses me off, Royale. And once again, you know, don't get me started, right? So, but really, that's just something I'm starting to see, is that people can't control themselves anymore. They have to vent. You know, when you vent, if you want to communicate, that's great. But when you sit there and abuse people and you harm people and you think it's okay to do so because Hollywood tells you that in a movie or a stupid series on television, you got problems, okay? This is what we call entrainment programming. It's called conditioning. They're entraining you to behave a certain way, and it's working really well. There's people that go on Facebook now, and they beat people up or they rape people, and then they put it on film. How disgusting is that? What the hell's wrong with the society? You want to tell me what the frick is wrong with everybody? Do you think that's appropriate behavior? Because it's not. Now, where across this timeline did people lose it? At what point in the continuum did people realize that they can't act that way in public, or they can't act that way? It's not appropriate to harm people like that. What the hell is wrong with society is really my question. And I'll tell you point blank, man, I don't know if it's a family breakdown. I don't know if it's lack of spirit. I would suspect it's a lot to do with lack of spirit, disconnect, entity takeovers, whatever you want to call them, because these people are now hosts for entities. They don't have any consciousness. They don't have any spirit. They don't have any soul. And this is a big deal. So one thing I have seen is a real kind of a disintegration of America insofar as the people and the children and the teenagers and the young adults. And it's very embarrassing and it's very disconcerting. Now, I may sound like one of these older generation people. I'm not. I'm not that old in the illusion of. I may be an old soul. But I'll tell you, man, I've seen a lot of things. And what really concerns me the most is how these people are so conditioned to stare at their little iPhones, to stare at their little iPads. That's all they do is hook their little cells into their little computers. And that's all they do all day long. They don't communicate. They don't know how to communicate. And when you ask them a question, they can't even respond coherently. This is a zombification society. So I guess that's my big rant for the day. But seriously, I mean, it has to be said. And I think that I know the listeners out here understand what I'm saying. But I'm done. You know, I'm really getting sick and tired of this crap. And I'm tired of people doing damage control in D.C. Every time Trump says something that is warranted, somebody wants to counterattack him. And they all want to jump on him like a horde. I'm sick of that BS. I'm tired of these ass clowns in D.C. I mean, how these people stay in D.C. and not be tried for treason is beyond me. Why the military doesn't step up and do their job, I have no freaking idea. Somebody foreign's paying their bank accounts. Bottom line. You know, sorry, guys, I used to have so much respect for our military and our law enforcement. I used to grow up thinking this country was perfect. And I'll tell you, I understand we have flaws, but I've never seen so much corruption in my entire frickin' life. And guess what? It's got to go. The good people have to make a change now. We've got to get this crap out of here. This is not acceptable. I don't know what kind of drugs they're on. I don't know if they're brain dead. I don't know if they're psychologically damaged. I think they're all entity controlled, and I think they're absolutely insane. And not only are they insane, it's a bleed-through virus to everybody else because Congress is acting psychotic. We've got people passing insane laws. Now they're telling people that they can't have an American flag when they're taking a tour of D.C. or the White House. What the frick is that all about? Really? You're telling me that? What are you doing in D.C.? What are you people doing in the White House when you don't belong there? If you don't like this country, if you don't like that flag, if you don't respect this land, get out of my country and get the hell out. Stop squatting in D.C. This is what pisses me off the most. And you as Americans really need to stand up and do something about it. You want this society. You know, I look at it and I think to myself, I think they want to be slaves. I think you all want to be slaves. You want to be plugged into the machine world. You want to sit there and not think for yourselves. You just want to be drooling with dribble cups and looking for fantasies or whatever the hell. This is what they want. Well, that's embarrassing because I'll tell you what, it's a big multiverse out there. And if you don't step up to the higher levels, you're never going to know it. You will never know the full light universe. You'll never know consciousness. You'll never know what we could have done as a country. And we came a very long way. And guess what? A Trojan horse came in and sabotaged the whole damn thing. So, and this is just me starting right away. I haven't had any coffee tonight, okay? So, but I did want to touch base on that just a little bit here because I think it's really important that we get into that realm of what's really happening here. I can't see anything good right now on the timeline in this country. It's very concerning. I mean, I see nice people from day to day, and you know what? I feel really sorry for them because a lot of them are like little sheep that are very sweet. They're very kind. Some of them are, not all. And they don't know what's going on. They don't have a clue. They're like, what? La La Land. They have no freaking idea, you know? It's like a train's coming down the track, and they're like, I don't know. They're just in another orbit. And you can say, well, you know, if they're not tuned into it, then it doesn't exist. Well, it really does exist. And there is a lot of unnecessary things that are happening here. There's a lot of orchestration going on, a lot of puppeteering. And this has been going on before most of us showed up on the timeline, even born in the illusion of birthing. I mean, this crap was going down before I showed up. I'm not bearing the cross for this crap. I mean, these people were at it before I showed up, and before half of you showed up, I'm sure. So all the garbage that they're doing here, man, this is unbelievable, the crap that they're pulling here on this timeline and in this country. And every day it gets worse. Every day I see people infringing I see these cabals and these organizations just taking people's rights away. And first of all, as a, you know, beyond sovereign, it's beyond sovereign. You're a celestial being, a multidimensional being. You're an energy in a form. I mean, you can go really vast in consciousness and say what you are, but you're an extension of the cosmos. End of story. I don't care for people trying to create titles and documents and paperwork saying we're this or we're that. They don't have any authority over anybody, but somewhere along the way, you gave them your power. You gave them your power. You allowed this to happen. And I'll tell you point blank, you know, you might want to reconsider who you're giving your power to from day to day. And you might want to consider when you turn on that filthy television in your home, who you're bringing into your house. Because every time you turn that TV on, you're inviting some creep to stay in your house, some creep from mainstream media that's lying to you. So pay attention to that as well. You know, I'm not going to lecture you guys. You're mature adults, hopefully. But I will say, if you have children, teach them well. Teach them courtesy. Teach them respect. Teach them not to harm animals. Teach them situation awareness. And teach them not to, you know, get sucked into mainstream media and Hollywood and all the illusion of fame and fortune. It's all a front. It's all a distraction. It's designed to do one thing, deter people's psyche into another area of deception. Okay. I mean, I like good movies too. And actually, you know, we're going to be talking about Rod Serling tonight. And I've always liked this Twilight Zone. But I'll tell you, Rod Serling took a lot of heat. A lot of the things that he had written in the past. And we're going to touch on that when Mike comes on the show. But, you know, it's sickening to me. It's not the same as it used to be in the old days. Even now you see the new Hollywood and the new music industry. It's not music anymore. These people are ass clowns. They're overpaid entertainers. They have no talent. Most of them lip sync. They're just a bunch of sluts on stage. Excuse my French. Male or female, I don't care. I don't see anything. I'm sorry. I don't see any class there. It just looks like a bunch of lowlifes to me. And I love music. I mean, I really do. But I'll tell you what, I'm really done with the corruption in the industry and what they do behind the scenes. And, of course, Hollywood is just a mask for other things as well. So, once again, you might want to consider where you're putting your funds, where you're putting your money. Are you giving money to all these areas? You know, another thing, I know people like to go to movies, and I'm not going to tell you not to. But I realize that you're giving these people money, and these people are your enemy. Okay, they're not supportive of America. They hate America. I can't figure out why they're even in Hollywood, because most of those people out there are doing dirty politics and so many things that are against our country and our freedom that I'm amazed. And I see it all the time. You know, I see all these people, these little puppeteered, mind-controlled entities from Hollywood trying to be out there promoting whatever candidate. And I'm thinking to myself, you people are nothing. Most of your homes are outside the U.S. Why are you even here? Oh, I see. So you can rip off the American people with Hollywood. I get it. Totally. So don't get me started with them either, because I can get really fired up. So anyways, I think I can wrap this up just about in a minute here or two. But that was something I wanted to mention to you guys. These are critical times right now, and I know everybody's doing their part here at the station. I try to tune into everybody's show. I'm very busy too, and I don't get to listen to everybody. But I'm very clear that there are people out there trying to do a good job, trying to put information out now as best they can, whether you realize it or not. And you do have to use discernment, obviously, but you know, start paying attention a little bit more and understanding that there's some real wars happening here. There are mental wars, psychic wars, spiritual wars, technological wars are out. They're just off the charts. The technological wars right now, you should be very concerned. You should be very, very concerned, because what they use and what they show you is nothing compared to what they've actually developed. And I can tell you, just from my own personal experience with artificial telepathy and psychotronic programs and what they did to me and how they were able to skate away in a courtroom after I testified, you want to see pissed off? I was pretty livid when that happened. When people like that commit a crime and they walk away with nothing, not a slap on the wrist, and ruin and destroy people's lives because they have a clearance to do something like that, that is not okay. And guess what? It's been going on for a long time. So if you are interested in, you know, I do have my books out on that. Nobody knows, nobody reads about them. I mean, they're kind of like, I don't know, cult classics at this point. But I have Eye of the Remote, Black Operations in Areas Beyond 52, which talks about the technology. It talks about the induction I went through. It talks about the trauma I went through. It talks about how it destroyed my life and my family, you know, and all that I worked for and all that I had. And all, I mean, seriously, I would have been retired by now. And of course, you know, to ground zero somebody's life like that, and then try to trash their brainwaves with an artificial intelligence array system is inexcusable. So, and if you think those technologies can't triangulate you and pull you in, yeah, dream on. Because I don't care how spiritual you are, how fortified you are, if they triangulate you, it's a tactical hardware. It's not personal, okay? It is a tactical hardware. It's an array system that triangulates the target, and it will tag you, pick you up, and interface you, and you won't even know what the hell happened to you, but you will traumatize. Your body will go into trauma. The vitals can drop. That's what happened to me. And then live feed real time. All of a sudden you have a handler there telling you how to act, walk, talk, think. And if you act up, boy, they'll take you down. They'll take you down with vertigo. They'll take you down with all sorts of attacks. They did it to me. You know, it's people don't seem to realize I get on here and I talk about stuff. You have no idea where I've been. And I don't bitch about it. I don't complain a whole lot. I mean, obviously, I talk about where I've been because I want people to understand there's a technology out there. People need to understand. But I don't sit here and whine 24 hours a day. I get in here and I interview people. And then I have my books out and I do other things. I try to stay as functional as I can. And I'm actually very functional because I'm the type that's like, I almost have an immunity to that freaking AI right now. I hate that thing, okay? Because I know what it can do to people's spirits and bodies and minds and souls. And you guys need to understand it's not your friend, okay? That technology is not your friend. I want you to understand that. That's the one thing that really came in very clear. I'm very loving, and I love science, and I love technology. But I'll tell you what, when people start interfacing people's brainwaves, and they try to dominate your brainwaves, say you want to do a prayer or say a prayer, you're not going to be able to because that thing's going to tell you what to say, or it's going to attack you every time you try to speak. Would you want that to happen to yourself? That's transhumanism, folks, but they don't tell you that part. They don't tell you how they brainwash and entrain people, right? So I won't get into further details with it, but I'll tell you, I've been through hell and back, and I understand the technology very well. And, of course, if I hear one more person tell me how fast I talk, I don't want to hear it anymore, okay, because that's how I learned to talk fast. I used to talk fast anyway, but when I was hijacked with the technology, they literally sped everything up, and then I had to defend myself so fast and so quickly, mentally, telepathically, with synthetic telepathy, and verbally, that I wound up really going super fast talking because I made sure I had my voice heard, and that thing wasn't going to be. In case anybody ever wants to know. All right. So you are listening to Ravenstar's Witching Hour. And I'm your host, Solaris BlueRaven. And this is freedomslips.com. And normally I don't talk, right, when I'm here. I'm usually talking about my guests, but I'm going to try and bring him in. Mike Pipher is his name. And let me read you his bio before I bring him in here. He's a great guy. He's been on the show before. I think you guys will appreciate him. I think he's a wonderful person. Michael Pipher is the archivist for the Rod Serling Archive. And for the past 9 years, he's been a volunteer at the Bundy Museum of History and Art in Binghamton, New York. And of course, that's Rod Serling's hometown. Mike's role as the volunteer archivist for the Rod Serling Archive is to locate and secure new material for the archive collection and exhibit and catalog existing items and to present several free programs each year. And these programs are called In the Zone. And each program has a specific theme. And their last In the Zone was Rod Serling in Binghamton, presented on, I think it was June 28th, this was a while back, and the 40th anniversary of his death. Other programs were Rod's time, travel themes, his war themes, his Christmas themes, and many more. And in 1971, Mike met Rod Serling at Binghamton's Broome Technical Community College, where he was a student, and Mr. Serling was on campus to speak, and Mike was privileged to talk with him for about 20 minutes. And as a fan of the Twilight Zone, after meeting Rod, Mike decided to begin researching and collecting Rod Serling-related material. And the Bundy Museum of History and Art features, changes, exhibits of history and local art of vintage barbershop, African art gallery, an exhibit of early time clocks telling the forgotten story of the origins of IBM. And IBM has a very dark side, too, by the way, I'm sure you guys are familiar with. And more, all surrounded by the Victorian grandeur of the National Register listed Harlow E. Bundy House. And that's located, actually, for those of you who live close by, it's at 129 Main Street in Binghamton, New York at 13905. You can call at 607-772-9179. And they're open from Tuesdays to Saturdays at 11 a.m. to 5 p.m. That sounds like a really cool museum. And open art gallery, they participate in Binghamton's first art walk every month featuring local art. And they do the clock exhibit, as I said before. They have some really cool stuff. So check it out. I'm going to pull him in right now. I think he's about ready. And let's see here. The website is bundymuseum.org, by the way. I'll put that in the chat room for you guys. Let me see if he's ready. I'll drag him in, and we'll be ready to rock and roll. I hope it's Skype. It sounds like a regular phone. Should I call his regular phone? Hang on, guys.
Hello?
Hi, did I call your regular phone?
Yes, you did. I'm on Skype waiting for you.
Okay, let me call Skype. Okay, hang on. Just let me disconnect and I'll call your Skype. Okay, you guys, hang on for a minute there. That's weird. I shouldn't be doing that, but it did. That's bizarre. Hello?
There we are.
Wow, you sound 100% better. Amazing.
Yeah.
Holy cow. Yeah,
there's a big difference from the stupid cell to this thing here.
Well, I just read your bio, Mike, and I tell you what, you have such an impressive bio. And before that, I did a nice little rant for everybody and just kind of talking about our freedoms and how they're being violated. And before we get into a lot of things, I did give your bio, but I want to talk and touch base a little bit about some of the problems that Rod Serling went into before when he started writing his work and how he was treated in Hollywood and how they were kind of infringing on his freedom insofar as freedom of expression and freedom of what he was trying to communicate. And we get into that. Yeah. And also
it's great because I was going to bring in his relationship to the blacklisting with Trumbo and things, and you're right in line with that.
Perfect. Well, you let me know where you want to start. I'm going to give you the floor. And however you want to start this, if you want to start insofar as how you got involved in the museum itself and how you got involved in meeting Rod Serling and what inspired you, and then we can go down the path how Rod Serling got involved in all this insofar as what happened to him and how he was treated and all that.
Okay. So are we on?
Yes, we are, and welcome. I'm very happy to have you. We are live.
Hi, Solaris. This is Mike, of course, and I'm looking forward to doing your show again with you on the life and career of Rod Serling.
Great. Awesome.
So, I'll follow your lead as far as what you want to start with.
Okay, well, that sounds good. Well, we'll tell everybody how you got involved in the museum, first of all.
With the museum itself, it started about 10 years ago when a gentleman came to town and opened up the museum. And, excuse me. He sent word out through a cousin of mine that worked for him rebuilding the old time clocks and things. And I didn't want to go in. I had been, involved with the Serling Foundation from 86 through 93 and just didn't want to get sucked back into the whole thing, frankly. But he insisted, and after about a year I went in. I did a few videotape interviews. And he said, "You're such a wealth of information." He says, "I'd really like you to work with the museum and build up what we'll call the Rod Serling Archive Collection." So my function at the beginning was to do all of the purchasing, of anything and everything to do with Rod Serling. And he had already purchased through me after we lost our house 10 years ago. I had sold some things to some antique dealers in town. And then 90% of what I owned was actually lost in the house. And thank God for the unman that the mortgage people hired to clean out the place. He knew the stuff was of value. He didn't have any contact information to me. So he sold it to different area antique dealers. And Michael Weinstein, the founder of the museum, being an antique dealer himself, would comb these shops. And he literally bought almost everything that I had ever accumulated over the 40-year period since I've been researching Rod Serling from 1971 when I met him twice in college. So thank God most of that material existed. And that was the beginning of the archive collection. Excuse me.
Do you need some water, Mike? Let me know if you do, okay?
Yeah, I've got a bottle right here.
Okay, great.
You know, I have this chronic cough. I apologize.
I know you do. I wish I could heal you on that. That's okay.
I wish you could do it. It's been 10 years and doctors can't figure it out. So at any rate, he says, "Well, here's a credit card for the museum." He says, "I want you to do all the buying, anything and everything that you can find." So, I comb through eBay, I comb through Amazon, but I do Google searches every night researching, and I come across a lot of things from different sources. And so we've been very fortunate. We have a couple thousand items now in the archive collection. And for those of you that haven't heard me on the show before, we actually opened April 14th of last year. We opened a permanent exhibit in the museum itself, and we're in the back building, the Annex Theater. And although the room is not as big as we'd like, we rotate it every 6 months to accommodate some new material. So actually, next Saturday, the 16th, we will be, debuting a new exhibit room. Very little will be the same, and we'll be having one wall that really excites me. We've expanded out into the main Annex Theater, and we're doing a huge wall on Planet of the Apes by itself. I wanted something, a real showpiece, a real eye catcher for the redoing of the exhibit next week. So we found a French movie poster that's 4 feet wide by 7 feet tall. That is a stone litho process, the most amazing, stunning, vivid colors, just an amazing piece. And that'll be the central focus. Of course, for some of your listeners that don't know, Rod Serling did write the original Planet of the Apes movie with Charlton Heston. And so we also have the American one-sheet poster will be there, copies of the first page of the script that he had written, the first 20 drafts, actually 4 years earlier than the movie came out, back in 64. And the let me grab a drink here.
Okay.
They were all rejected because of the cost factor, basically, in trying to bring this movie to the screen. So after 2 years, he was still involved with Twilight Zone when he was writing all of these strips. Everything just fell by the wayside. And it wasn't until 1968 that he was recontacted and hired to co-write it with Michael Wilson. And actually, they didn't really co-write. They both had their own script versions, and they would just take sections of each other's, although 90% of it is still Rod's original work. So we have the second draft that he ever wrote back in 64, and we have the final shooting script. And, you know, we're pleased to be able to prove between the two different scripts that Rod certainly did create the famous ending with the Statue of Liberty and that you're here on Earth all along. Mm-hmm. There's been a lot of controversy over that through the years. So that'll be one focus that's not part of the room itself. And then another wall in the Annex Theater will be about 12 blow-up photographs of Rod Serling growing up here in Binghamton. We have photographs when he's about 3 years old, right through, and he went away to the war. And then when he came back, excuse me, in the 70s, where I met him at college, he came back to my school four different times between 71 and 75 when he passed away. So that would just be Rod Serling in Binghamton, a complete section of its own.
Mm-hmm. That sounds fantastic. You know, and it's funny because we touched on this before when you were on my other show, Hyperspace, and I didn't realize that he had written the ending to Planet of the Apes or had been a participant in that whole book. And it was like, wow, what that's like the best thing ever is that ending is classic with the Statue of Liberty. And you have to ask yourself, there was an ominous presence about him. We've touched on it before. It was almost like he could see between the parallels of what was happening here. And I kind of wonder what he would think today with all the strange things that are happening in America. I bet he's flipping in his grave sometime, I swear, in the illusion of, right?
Yeah, I would imagine, because, you know, he was so outspoken against all forms of racism, bigotry, hatred, war. I mean, he just was really outspoken, especially from the late 60s when he was mainly living off of narrating different programs and, of course, Night Gallery, but he didn't have much to do with that actual series. So we have an independent film series, about 8 films a year. And I went last week to see one called Sir, Yes, Sir, on the Vietnam War from its beginning through its ending. And I never realized how our soldiers were so against the war, not just a lot of the country. And there were some horrible things in there that we went through. But the reason I went to that was to tie Rod Serling in at the end. We actually sat there and talked for an hour, about 25 people and I, about Rod Serling's feelings about war in general after what he went through in the Philippines in World War II. And we were able to show to the people that were there that Rod Serling not only was protesting the Vietnam War and really vehemently in the 70s. I mean, you know, he no holds barred with the media. He'd use the F word. He was really mm-hmm. into protesting. But the main focus was Rod Serling was the first writer to bring the Vietnam War to television. Two episodes of The Twilight Zone, one in the first season, actually has the words Vietnam War on screen with the year that this episode was taking place. And then the last season in 65 was a classic episode with Jack Klugman and Bill Mumy from Lost in Space. And that dealt with the Vietnam War, too, with a young boy dying over in Vietnam and the father, you know, through a time travel thing, being able to take his place, and was powerful. So you had one that dealt with the whole Vietnam War and the other one that was set during the Vietnam War. So Rod was the first one to bring that to television. And he was also the first one to bring to television the aftermaths of a nuclear war. And, of course, that's first season, Time Enough at Last with Burgess Meredith.
Yeah, my favorite.
Yeah, where he breaks his glasses. It's just a classic, mm-hmm. classic episode. And then two nights later, I went back to the museum for a new reading. We have a group here, Southern Tier Actors Read. And this was on the Dalton Trumbo blacklisting. It was based on letters from Dalton Trumbo to his son, Christopher. And it's just an amazing two-hour program. And again, I was able to tie Rod Serling in to the blacklisting. Rod Serling was accused of being a communist for many, many years in the mid-50s. And he hated the blacklisting that was going on. And so as far back as 1955 with Patterns, the first Playhouse No, that was a crap that he won his first Emmy for. But in 56, with Requiem for a Heavyweight and Patterns, he started using blacklisted writers and actors. And he really, I mean, this is McCarthy was still going strong in 54, 5, and 6 with the hauling people in. Where did Ridley started with Trumbo and 10 writers in 1947. By the mid-50s, it was up to over 200 people. Famous actors and writers and directors and producers that were hauled in. And Rod just fought vehemently, and he said, look, he says, you know, my first show, Requiem for Heavyweight, 90 minutes, won national acclaim, considered the best thing ever on television. And if you want me to do the other 8 or 9 episodes that we have planned, I'm going to use these people. And he fought and he won. And, you know, he was the first one to really bring the blacklisted people into the foreground. It wasn't actually until Kirk Douglas with Spartacus in 1960 that he was able to put Dalton Trumbo's name on screen for the first time since 1943 as the writer of the movie. And from that point, there were still problems, but Rod Serling used a lot of blacklisted writers and actors throughout the 5 years of The Twilight Zone as well. So the museum has something going on every night. And whenever I have an opportunity to go to something that I know I can tie Rod Serling into, I make it a point to do that. And the people that are there are fascinated because, you know, most of them, frankly, didn't even know Rod Serling was from Binghamton. You're getting a lot of people that, you know, younger people that don't know Rod's history and background and how it's tied in here. And to be able to share with some new people some information that's important not only to our area, but to society as a whole. I mean, they, you know, war is a terrible thing. I think I mentioned on one of your programs when Rod Serling was still in the war or had just gotten home, there's a 38-page document that was discovered recently in the archives at Madison, Wisconsin. Rod had donated 80 boxes of his letters and documents and things there when they requested it in the 60s. And they unearthed this document, and it's called the First Squad, First Platoon. And it starts out saying that I'm writing this letter. It's only to be seen by any future children that I might have so that they can learn of the horrors of war from me. Mm-hmm. And it's just an amazing piece. Mm-hmm. I've seen it. We don't have a copy, but we are getting a copy of it very soon. Excellent. So, you know, I love the opportunity to be able to share, you know, new things, you know, every time we have a program. So my program next Saturday night, we do programs called In the Zone. I do 3 or 4 a year. And this one's going to be Rod Serling's Time Travel Revisited.
Cool.
2 years ago, I did the first time travel one. And we had the largest crowd ever. It was standing room only. It's a small theater, but it was great to fill it. And I think we will again. We have a great program lined up.
Well, that sounds fantastic. Yeah. And of course, if people want to get in touch, I did read your bio when I had you off air. I was reading your bio, so they do know. But give them a rundown insofar as how they can contact you if they were interested or maybe swinging by or something. What's the best way to contact?
The best way is to use our – we have our own archive website. It's called rodserlingarchive.org. And if you forget that, just go to Rod Serling Archive. And it'll bring in our website, and then there's a link there for an email directly to me. So that link is simply rodserlingarchive@gmail.com. And I'm the only one that gets the mail, and I do answer every one of them, although I don't go on sometimes for 3 or 4 days. There was a period, as you know, for a month I didn't have a computer. It crashed. So we have a new one now, and I'm having nothing but trouble with it. So it's really been a frustrating week trying to put the program together.
Well, you sound great. Skype sounds really good. That's for sure. So you know, it's interesting. It's like you're carrying the torch for Rod Serling. And I've told you this before. I really applaud you for doing that because he was so unique. He was such a unique person and had so many different abilities. And it's amazing. When you look back at everything he wrote about, there was a real deep message behind every single episode of his work.
Yes, there was. You know, for your listeners, you know, he started back in 1949 when he was still at Antioch College in Ohio, Yellow Springs, Ohio, and he was working on the radio station, and before long he was running the radio station for the school, and then he moved into working for radio and television in 1950 in Cincinnati. And from there, it was mostly radio in the first couple of years, and he wrote hundreds and hundreds of live radio shows, But for the most part, they were really terrible, terrible, terrible pieces because he was basically a staff writer and he was told what he had to write. They had him writing crazy jingles that, you know, if you were to hear some of them today, you would just laugh yourself crazy. I mean, they're so bad. And he knew they were horrible and he wanted more. So he started writing dramatic television, which really in this country started in 49, the first TV stations. And most of them were independent. And around 1951, some started going national. So he wrote 28 episodes in 1951 and 2 for a series called The Storm that was a local series in WLW in Cincinnati. And one of those episodes has survived thanks to Rod's foresight. It was called The Storm, No Gods to Serve. It was about the Korean War. And again, it's the same thing, pretty much anti-war theme of, you know, a commanding officer having to send some of his troops out on a suicide mission. And, you know, and it wasn't too well received. So anyways, Rod had a kinescope made. For your listeners that don't know what a kinescope is, they would take a 16-millimeter film camera and put it on a tripod in front of a television screen. And then as the show was broadcast live, they would film it. So whatever flaws were in the broadcast, if the signal went in and out or the sound went in and out, that's what you captured. And it's called a kinescope recording. So thank God there's, you know, a lot of those around of some of Rod's works, but probably 70 of the major works he did in the 50s are lost. They were never filmed, or if the kinescope was made, there was one and they've just been destroyed or misplaced or whatever. Mm-hmm. So Rod had the foresight. He knew this was a good episode, and he paid $400 to have the thing filmed himself, and he only made $50 for the script. But he wanted it in the hopes that he could sell it later to the networks, which he did. And so 2 years later, it did air nationwide on a bigger program, either a craft or one of those type of shows in the early 50s. So a lot of Rod's works have survived, but the majority really haven't. We're lucky at the museum. We've pulled about 15 of these live shows from the 50s. Called the Golden Age of Television, anywhere from 1950 to 1960. That's what it's commonly referred to. And we have several pieces that were filmed that we copied to video back in the 70s and 80s and now onto DVD. And those are available for people to watch if they stop by. They can go through a list of our holdings and screen anything they'd like. And many of the pieces we have, the Serling family does not have. The UCLA archives in California, Paley Center in New York and California do not have either. So we're really privileged to have found some pieces. One piece in particular I had been looking for 30-some years. And, you know, we just got it in about 9 months ago in the presence of Mine Enemies, which was the last Playhouse 90 from 19. I think that aired in 1960. And although Rod wrote it several years earlier and presented it, the networks and the studio for Playhouse 90 said that we will air this, but not until we know it's going to be the last episode of Playhouse 90, which had ran for about 8 years, because we're going to have so much hate mail and they're going to ban it from television and it would kill us. So we're just going to wait and do it then. And it did all of that. it was a story of the Warsaw Ghetto in Poland during the war and how out of 500,000 Jewish people that lived in that small ghetto area, only 50 or less survived. They were all butchered in a matter of days. And it was such a unique and powerful piece because Robert Redford, by the way, it was his first starring role in television, and he played a young Nazi soldier that felt bad at what he was being ordered to do to the people. And he actually comes to the rabbi, who was played by Charles Laughton, one of the best actors we ever had, and gets down on his knees and puts his head on his lap, and he's weeping and he begs for forgiveness, and the rabbi forgives him. And it's just so powerful. Rod personally received over 3,000 hate letters from rabbis and prominent Jewish leaders around the world saying, how write something like this and put this on television?
What? Well, you just blanked out there, mister. What happened? What did he say? Because you just blanked out, Mike. Where'd you go? Mike? Can you hear me? Oh, he's just, your audio, are you on mute? Because I can't hear you. Oh, God dang it. Hang on, everybody. Must have been my rant. Must have been impressed. Stand by. Reconnecting. Oh, brother. Hang on, everybody. We're working on this over here. I've got a reconnection problem. Oh, God. I'm sure that we still have the server, even though I'm still trying to get Mike. And looks like it's in the red. So hang on, everybody. We're trying to get him back here. It'll be just a second. I'd sing you a song, but it's not going to work. So I wonder if I should just try to hang up and let me try and get him again, everybody. That was very odd. Let me try again. 1,000, 2,000. There you are. Hi, Mike.
Oh, my God. I don't know what happened. I don't think it was on my part.
No, it wasn't. I don't know. Something's glitchy there. But what's you were talking about the rabbi, and then all of a sudden you mentioned something about the calls, but we didn't get that part, so we'll start there again.
Yes, the Robert Redford character was weeping on basically his head on the lap of Charles Lawton, begging forgiveness for what he was forced to do, and the rabbi forgave him. And the hate mail just flooded in. There was over 3,000 letters, Rod told, in some of his speeches that came to him directly, criticizing him for writing such a piece and getting this on television. You know, these Jewish leaders were just furious, saying, how dare you, you know, forgive this young Nazi soldier. And, of course, CBS, the hate mail, was even worse. And so it was considered a lost film for 35, 40 years. And yet somehow I knew it existed because in around 1987, PBS station nationwide, it was the American Masters television series that aired on PBS, came to Binghamton and filmed a segment. And in there, they showed a five-minute clip of the ending that I just talked about. And the quality was amazing. I said, somewhere this live kinescope is out there. And finally, last year, about 9 months ago, I tracked it down. And like I said, I'd been looking for that for almost 40 years. I'd never seen it.
Wow. How did you track it down? Where do you go when you're hunting for his work? Where do you go?
Well, very briefly, in the early 70s, for about 35, 40 years, I was buying 16-millimeter film packages just as a collector. And that's how I actually started collecting Rod Serling material, finding Twilight Zones on film and some of these live television shows from the 50s. So after doing shows around the country, 10, 15 shows a year, buying and selling these rare films, I've made contacts that are just unbelievable. And finally, just one of them hit pay dirt and came up with the print and was gracious enough to give us a DVD of it.
That's awesome. I'm so glad. Yeah, you've told me stories about some other stuff that you've acquired. And I forget what actor it was. You had something for him, too. And I can't remember that story now. But yeah, it's pretty interesting.
Most of what I collected on film was vintage television, not just feature films. And through that, I quickly realized that celebrities could not get their own material. I would watch Carson every night, The Late Show, and these actors would be on there every week saying, you know, I did this, this, and this, and I can't find any of them, and the studios never would let us have anything back in the old days. A matter of fact, today even, I know Jeff Bridges, for example, unless you're making $20 million a picture, you can't get a copy of your own film. Wow. I mean, I can remember Jeff back in 86 when I was on the set of Jagged Edge with him at Warner Brothers Studios. He said, you know, I'm making $5 million a picture now. I just finished Starman, and Dad wants me to try and find some of these old things, and I can't get them. The studios will not give them to me. But, of course, since Jeff won his Oscar a few years ago, now he can almost, you know, demand it, which a lot of the bigger name actors do. But back then, they could not get their material. So I would find addresses. There was a book out in 2000 TV star, you know, movie star addresses. And I found Lloyd Bridges, for example, and sent him a nice letter and a couple of videos of some of his early material. And so I did that with lots of people. I've gotten to know over 100 celebrities, you know, from Bill Cosby to Bob Hope to, you know, it just goes, Phyllis Diller. It goes on and on and on. Sure. And it was all through my film collecting, just like the Rod Serling began for me the same way.
That's amazing. But don't you see a difference between the old Hollywood and what's there now? It just seems to me like what's there now is embarrassing compared to the really good quality films and the actors back then.
You know, yeah, back then you had, you know, of course, in the 30s, 40s, and 50s, you still had the star system. And I said, you know, if you were big box office and were so well known, you know, you weren't making the kind of money they do today, but you still had some power over what scripts you were going to do, things like that. And of course, in the early, you know, days, if you were first under contract for 10 years, you had to do whatever they threw at you. You did not have that say. Betty Davis was a great example. She's the one that fought in the early 50s and says, I'm not doing this garbage anymore. And she lost millions of dollars and tens of millions of dollars and was sued and didn't work for a couple of years. But, you know, today, you know, they bring in a lot of these new people, and there's still a lot of good talent out there. There's some amazing talent out there. But it seems like the work is so lacking. They're going back and recycling strips from 10, 20, 30 years ago, and not just from good movies like Gone with the Wind or Casablanca and stuff. You know, they took Casablanca and made a movie, Rosebud, about the sled. But they're doing garbage movies that didn't do any business 30 years ago and recycling them, like the Beverly Hillbillies movie and McHale's Navy movie. I mean, they're taking vintage TV that was classic or vintage movies that were great and redoing them. And they're not doing any better box office today than they did then. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it just seems like there's a lack of good writers.
Right, and it's all CGI, too. A lot of it's just special effects and no real dialogue. That's another thing, you know, when you look back at the classics, and I like the old classics. I like black and white film. I'm really big on black and white because it's very dramatic. But I'll say, you know, back then, even with Rod Serling, for example, the way he wrote, I mean, the way he communicated, the depth and the level of his communication is like, they don't do that anymore. And even when they try to redo his work, it just doesn't, it's not the same.
Yeah, it's not the same. For example, Night Gallery, which, you know, Rod Serling had very little control over. His name was used as the host, so it's Rod Serling's Night Gallery. After the first year and a half, they even refused to read any more scripts of Rod's, let alone film any more of them. And now, right now as we speak, J. Michael Straczynski is doing the new Night Gallery series. It's going to be a 5-part miniseries, and it's in production right now. So I'm just praying that he does some classic episodes that Rod did do for the Night Gallery. There were a few tremendous episodes that had critical acclaim. But who knows? It could be all modern writers and nothing to do with it other than the Night Gallery name again.
Mm-hmm. It's kind of like, how can you improve on his original work? That's my opinion anyway. You know, I look at the old classic films and the ones you sent me, thank you so much. I know you've been sending me all sorts of cool episodes and I so appreciate those. They're really wonderful to watch. They're very timeless, you know. It's kind of nice. It's almost like a settling because when you watch something like that, it's not the busyness of television today. There's a silence to it, a stillness.
Yeah, it is. It's amazing. And, you know, I've seen some of these shows of Rod's at least 100 times through the years. And,
Yeah, we're heading for a break, but we'll be right back. Hold that thought, Mike, and we'll be right back here at Ravenstar's Witching Hour with my special guest, Mike Pipher. Stay tuned.